Good evening, folks, and welcome to Ivy League Basketball. Tonight it's the Yale Bulldogs taking on the Ivy League leading Penn Quakers. Alongside Josh Hess, I'm John Ryan. Josh, tonight's game, both teams have already clinched spots in next week's Ivy League tourney, but still a big game, especially for Penn, who's trying to lock up the number one seed.
And Penn has the best defense in the Ivy League. Yale has a chance to make a statement win. They have yet to beat the top two teams, Penn and Harvard, this year. Last chance to do it tonight at home.
Should be a fun one. Stay tuned, folks. Lineups and tip when we come back. Welcome back, folks. Just about ready to get things underway here in the John J. Lee Amphitheater in New Haven, Connecticut. You're watching Ivy League basketball on 11 Sports. Josh, Penn coming in, number one in the Ivy League, taking on a Yale team that's qualified for the Ivy League tournament. What are you expecting tonight?
Well, this is a chance for Yale to get that end-of-season tune-up before the Ivy League tournament. They're locked into that number three position right now. They can't go up or down. Penn has the top defense in the Ivy League, holding opponents to a pretty poor shooting percentage, under 30% from three, 41% overall from the field. And when these two teams met back on February 3rd, Yale was just one of 19 from downtown. So it'll be important for Yale to establish themselves from beyond the three-point arc early on in this game.
Let's get you tonight's starting lineups. First of all, for the Penn Quakers in the backcourt, it's Darnell Foreman, the senior out of Camden, New Jersey, who will run the point. He's joined by Antonio Woods, back on the Quakers roster after missing last season. And Ryan Bentley, sharp-shooting wing, stands 6'5", out of Downington, Pennsylvania. In the front court, it's Max Rothschild, a junior out of Chicago, and A.J. Brodeur, an all-Ivy player, sophomore. Penn's second-leading scorer, but has been their leading scorer in Ivy League play. For the Bulldogs, in the backcourt, it's Alex Copeland, Trey Fills, and leading scorer Mie Oni. Oni really got his Ivy League season back on track last weekend. 26 points, 9 rebounds, 8 assists in the win over Columbia. In the front court, it's Blake Reynolds and the freshman Paul Atkinson. Reynolds also, after a slow start most of the season, Josh, seems to have found some footing here over the last couple of weeks. He's reached double figures in his last four games. Yale playing tonight in the white jerseys, white shorts with the blue trim. Penn in the blue with red trim. Quakers taking on Yale tonight. Tomorrow they'll face Brown in the concluding game of the Ivy League season. Yale tomorrow hosts Princeton on senior night. We're getting things underway. It's Oni who wins the tip, and the Bulldogs will get started. Alex Copeland gives to Oni. Round to Reynolds. Yale really struggled to get good looks last time against Penn. Scored only 50 points down in Philadelphia and shot 1 of 17 from beyond the arc. The other way, that's easy for Brodeur. Lackadaisical transition D cost the Bulldogs on their first defensive possession. Here's Reynolds. Nice pass to Atkinson underneath. Fouled. Basket's good. He'll head to the line.
Well, if you can't get it from beyond the arc, you might as well try the old-fashioned way. And, John, it's funny you say some lackadaisical transition defense. After the last game against Columbia, Mieoni said that the team was running the floor well and that they were getting back and doing well on transition defense. Guys were spreading the floor and where they needed to be at the right time. So just a good, quick start from Penn to set Yale back on their heels early.
Yeah, and it really hasn't been too much of an issue. Bulldogs generally have done a pretty good job getting back in transition D this year. Haven't had quite the offensive rebounding presence they've had the last couple of seasons. And so I think they made a little more, put a little more focus on that aspect and that decision of whether to send the extra guy for the offensive rebound or get back in transition. Trey Fills tips the cross-court pass out of bounds. Already, though, you're seeing the ball movement that has typified this Quaker offense. Nice pass by Broder. Underneath, Rothschild stripped out of bounds. It will stay at that end.
Now the Penn bench asking for the shot clock to be reset. They claim that the ball hit the rim. Shot clock right now at 2, so that's pretty important.
And I think the officials think it hit maybe the underside of the backboard, not the rim. So 2 seconds on the shot clock. Nice pass to Rothschild. That's too easy.
Well, that's how you beat the quick shot clock, and we saw it last night with Virginia against Louisville under a second to go, down 4, and they worked some quick points, and Penn doing the same thing to Yale.
Yeah, Bentley that time really served to distract the Yale defense, and that left Rothschild wide open. Reynolds tries from deep, misses, rebound Woods. He gives it to Foreman, and Penn going right at this Yale defense. Rothschild gives it to Woods, guarded by Oney. This pass to Foreman in the corner. Foreman tries a 3, rattles home. Foreman, not a great 3-point shooter, only 25% on the season, but gets the first one to go.
Neither of these teams shot well from beyond the 3-point arc when they first met a month ago.
Phil stripped. Penn, maybe with numbers, it's Foreman, and he'll slow things down. Pass over to Bentley for 3, misses. And Oney gathers for the Bulldogs. Fills into the lane with the left. Scoops and scores.
Great strong take there by Trey Fills. Just put his head down like a running back, bolt through the lane. And that's what Yale needed to bring this back to a one-score game.
And after averaging, I think, maybe 6 points a game in non-conference play, he's been Yale's leading scorer in Ivy League action, 13 points a game. Trey Fills, easily the most valuable Bulldog in the Ivy League. Foreman hits the fadeaway.
Fills also coming off a big weekend last weekend. He had 33 total points against Cornell and Columbia, 17 and 16 respectively.
Here's Fills again. Gives it to Oney, coming off a screen. Oney will go to the basket. Broder challenges the shot, and he did a great job there. Oney well off the mark. Now Broder running, but he traveled. Caleb Wood checks in the game. Rothschild will head to the bench. Wood averaging just north of 9 points a game this season. A pretty solid 3-point shooter at 36%. And he had a good game last time out against the Bulldogs, 14 points in the Quaker victory. Oney looking for Atkinson, another Yale turnover. It's been an issue at times this season for the Bulldogs. Bentley misses. Oney, strong rebound. Ball knocked loose again. Broder, great hands. This time, though, Yale recovers. Copeland out to Reynolds. Oney. Reynolds underneath. Misses, gets it back, and lays it in. You're seeing, Josh, how good this Quaker defense is.
Yeah, we got a chance to see two different aspects of it there. Yale tried to run in transition. Penn just wouldn't let them near the basket. And then the Bulldogs had a second chance opportunity. The defense was set, but a nice finish inside to get back on the scoreboard.
Broder, pass underneath, blocked by Reynolds. Exciting first 4 minutes and 33 seconds of action. You're watching Yale Penn on 11 Sports.
You can make it if you try, you can make it if you try.
leads Yale 9-6 early on. Quakers with the basketball. And they'll inbound to Broder. Three-pointer on the way. Wood misses. Oney another rebound.
All 6 points for Yale so far have come in the paint. That's a product of this really good Penn defense. Once again, they hold teams to under 30% shooting from three-point range.
Copeland wide open from the corner misses. Yale just can't buy a three against Penn this year. Oney with the left. Nice move.
And that miss from Copeland wasn't even because of good Penn defense. That was just a wide open look. Left it a little right.
Broder into the lane, past Oney. Noah Yates has checked into the ball game for the Bulldogs. He has the ball now underneath and threw it off the back of the backboard. Kind of lost his balance. I don't know if he got bumped maybe by Bentley.
Tough pass for him to grab too.
What can you say about Noah Yates though? Yale fans who watched last weekend against Cornell and what was a critical game on Friday, Yale playing for its Ivy League tournament lives. Noah Yates, former walk-on, 17 points off the bench, including a couple huge threes down the stretch to win the game for Yale. And really a magical performance by the senior. Very well deserved.
John, I think it could come down to somebody like that again tonight coming up big for Yale. This is a really good Penn defense. Yale struggled against them in the first meeting. And in that meeting, it was Paul Atkinson with 20 points, 13 rebounds, the first double-double for the first year. And tonight, it could be somebody else.
Azar Swain and Eric Monroe check into the game. Copeland and Phils head to the bench. Here's Monroe with the basketball. Gives it to Swain. Swain has been so deadly from beyond the arc this season for Yale. 41%. And there's a foul. It's Oney who draws it. Penn, of course, this year really back at the top of the Ivy League, where a lot of Quakers fans think they should be. And credit goes to their head coach, Steve Donahue, in his third season at the helm. Of course, saw the work he did at Cornell a number of years ago. Trip to Boston College in between that. Return to the Ivy League. Sits on the bench for the Quakers and has done a fantastic job rebuilding this program. They come into this game at 21-7. On the other bench, it's James Jones in his 19th season leading the Yale Bulldogs. Another top four finish, his 18th in a row.
Well, all the credit in the world to Steve Donahue for this year. It had been two mediocre years back in the Ivy League for the head man, and he has just done a really good job. Now he's got his own players in the system, and it's still a very young team for Penn. They have a really high ceiling these next few years, and, of course, the Ivy League tournament at the Palestra, so if the students get back from break-in time, it'll be a hometown crowd for them next weekend.
Yeah, one of those young guys, sophomore Devin Goodman at the line now. Goodman, though, has struggled from the stripe, misses the first. That makes him only 8 of 19 from the line this season. But a couple other guys, A.J. Broder, we've talked about a lot already tonight, a sophomore, Ryan Bentley, their leading scorer, a sophomore. Quakers with a 4-point lead and a whistle. Foul off the ball. That'll go against Max Rothschild. His second. And so Broder will re-enter the game. Monroe to inbound. Gets it to Yates. Yates underneath to Reynolds. Reynolds lost it. Now to the right hand. Off the mark.
Tough look there for Reynolds, just blind to the basket, threw it up.
Goodman underneath to Broder. Broder fought off Oney and Yates and had an easy lay-in. Quakers really have made things tough for Yale the early going. Swain driving baseline, loses it. Foreman taking it himself with a left hand. James Jones, timeout. Quakers lead this one 16-8. Timeout on the floor. You're watching Ivy League basketball on 11 Sports.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
It's a new year, and we're pleased to get our re-air series rolling again with the March 2018 men's basketball matchup between the Yale Bulldogs and the Penn Quakers. I'm Evan Ellis, and to talk about this big win, we're excited to be joined by the head coach of the Bulldogs, James Jones. And Coach, how are you?
I'm tremendous, Evan. Always glad to see you. Happy to be on and talking a little Yale basketball.
Let's go back to this 2017-2018 season as we look back at this Penn game. This is a team that had a very difficult pre-Ivy League schedule and learned a lot about themselves as a basketball team early on.
Well, that's really what you want to do every year, Evan. You want to be challenged in your non-conference and really try to find out what your rotations are going to be and who's going to be able to step up in the big moments for you. And we certainly were able to do that, and that helped guide us to another championship.
Going into this Penn game, you all were coming off a road loss at Harvard, followed that up with a pair of wins the weekend prior. But the Bulldogs had lost to the Quakers earlier on the road, and both teams were in need of wins for positioning for the Ivy League tournament.
Yeah, you know, it was one of those things that you can never be in a situation where you're very comfortable with what's going on in the league. And when you lose a game here or there, it's always going to be a little bit tough for you. And we certainly wanted to make sure we were going to be able to make a statement in this game and be able to get back on continue on a winning side. And especially when you're at home, you want to win all your home games, and that's always been really important for us.
Talking about some of the players that made big plays in this game, Trey Fills led the team with 24 points and Miaoni chipped in 23. Trey Fills was such a special player, and you asked him to do a lot of different things over the course of his Yale career.
Yeah, you know, I was actually thinking about Trey yesterday. I saw something on Twitter or Instagram about him, and, you know, he's a tremendous young man. And, you know, he's the kind of kid every coach wants on their team because he's going to do whatever it takes to be successful. And he gave probably more of himself than most anybody else on this team. And, you know, to win a championship, everybody has to sacrifice, and there has to be a number of people to sacrifice. But I certainly think that Trey sacrificed a lot. And, you know, he was our defensive stopper, and we asked him to forgo his offensive output every game and to just sit on the best player on the other team and make their life really difficult. And he was able to do that for us. And in this game, he was on fire, made three after three for us and was able to get to the rim. And we needed everything he gave us in that game. And we were certainly happy to have him. And I'd have him back in a heartbeat.
As a coach in this Ivy League environment, the Friday, Saturday back-to-backs, you have to divvy up the responsibilities for the game plans. What goes into the week knowing that you'll have to install two separate game plans for sometimes two totally different teams?
Well, you know, if you think about the pandemic going on right now, I've been asked by a number of coaches around the country, how do you play games back-to-back? Because you're seeing that happening with a lot of these schools that people are playing back-to-back now. So for us, the planning throughout the week is something that we've developed over my years at Yale. And on Monday, it's always Yale. We're going to review the tape of the last weekend, both good and bad, and then work on the things that we need to get better at. Say if our offensive movement wasn't great or our defensive rotations wasn't there, we're going to work on those things. And then on Tuesday, we try to sneak something in on both teams, that they do collectively. So let's say both teams are going to ice ball screens. So we're going to work on ice and ball screens on our offense against ice and ball screens on that Tuesday in practice, try to get something that both those teams do. And then on Wednesday, we're going to prepare for that Saturday team. And again, we kind of sneak it in, and we don't talk a lot about that Saturday team. We're going to sneak it in on Wednesday and go over their offensive sets. And then on Thursday, we're going to prep for our Friday game. And then we'll have a walkthrough on Saturday morning before the Saturday game, working on the stuff that we worked on Wednesday. And our guys are great at really remembering what went on and understanding what their responsibilities are. And, you know, we certainly have a package of what we do on both sides of the ball. And we kind of lend ourselves to just making sure we do that. But if there's anything specific that we need to work on and throughout what the teams that we're going to be playing do, our guys are really good at picking that stuff up and knowledgeable about it. And my assistant coaches do a great job at making sure we get that information to them.
This game was back and forth. And coming down to the wire, the Bulldogs were down 3 with 7 seconds left. And you were able to get an incredible play from Paul Atkinson to seal the win.
Well, you know, there's a lot that went into that play. You know, we kind of drew it up from Mie to get a 3 in a corner. So Blake Reynolds had to throw a tremendous pass to Mie, who caught it. And he didn't have a shot right away, and he drove it. And because, you know, Mie was Mie, and he's going to draw so much attention, Paul's man stepped up to try to stop Mie, and he just dished it off, something that he's great at doing. As a matter of fact, that was a thing that really caught my eye when we recruited Mie, his ability to pass the basketball and find his teammates and make them better. You know, he had over 100 assists, I believe, in his his sophomore year, and it was tremendous for him to help us win. And in any event, he was able to dump it off the Paul, and all Paul had to do was lay it in. You know, as he made his life easy. Like I could almost made that layup. Maybe I could have made it, you know, especially back in the day. But he made it easy for Paul to just catch and score. And that's what Paul does. I mean, the kid's shot 70% for his career. And I always felt good when he had the basketball, but it was a tremendous pass by Blake, tremendous catch and drive by Mie, and a nice dump off the Paul, who finished the game. And, you know, there's nothing better than watching the excitement of your guys after a game-winning basket like it was, and guys rushing the floor and jumping on Paul. And it was just a tremendous sight. And I got to tell you, though, I believe that it was more the Yale crowd and playing at home that willed us to that win, because it was a comeback victory. We were down by 3 with seconds to go, but it was the whole last few minutes where they banked some baskets to take a lead, and we actually slowly crept back in and stole a game. Yale has always been a very difficult place for Penn to win, and it was never true. Never those truer words were never spoken after the way that one finished.
Coach Jones, thank you for your time. It's great to catch up and look back at this big win for the Bulldogs, and I can't wait until we get to do it again.
All right, listen, you take care, Evan, and always a pleasure to talk to you, and always happy to talk about Yale basketball.
That was Yale head coach James Jones. Yale and Penn from 2018 continues now.
Atkinson, so that means Oney will play the 4, although against this Penn lineup, really is only one traditional big man in Broder. To see, I mean, James Jones has not hesitated to try to post up Mie Oney in these situations. We'll see if they go to that look at the other end. Wood again for 3.
Just so difficult to stop that. 3 consecutive threes made. Bulldogs had a 3-point chance at the line, and luckily for them, Copeland converted all 3, but Yale is going to have to figure something out from the perimeter.
Oney gets the ball back. Sends it to the corner. Swain, tough shot, hand in the face, misses. Phil's going after it, and they'll say it's Yale basketball. It looked like Phil's, from our perspective, maybe got his hand in there last, but the Bulldogs get another chance, and they'll see if they take it when we come back. Quakers have opened up an 11-point lead, 8 minutes to play in the first half. Penn with an 11-point lead, 3-point shooting, a big reason why, Josh.
Yeah, right now 5 of 9 from the field, and John, between the 2 media timeouts, Penn made 4 baskets. All 4 were from 3.
Copeland gives it to Swain. You know, close to the starting lineup on the floor. Instead of Atkinson, Swain out there. Copeland, some space. He's fouled, and it falls.
You have to imagine that Yale knows they're not getting anything from beyond the arc, so there Copeland just takes it himself, wants to go the old-fashioned way. He's already hit three free throws. A chance for another.
Copeland, 5 points tonight. Completes the three-point play.
And John, we can see with Monroe checking in for Swain, not having a big man there, that James Jones is sacrificing another big man in the middle there for some perimeter defense to try to limit these Penn three-pointers.
Bentley backdoor cut went right by Trey Phils.
Of course, you lose another rim protector there that can hang out on the other side.
Reynolds will try a three, and the woes continue for the Bulldogs. Foreman right at Copeland. Nice job by Alex Copeland, forcing him to retreat. This time, pass. Bentley to the basket. Offensive foul. Or check, yeah. Offensive foul on Bentley. Officials looked at one another, and then they made the call. I think the Penn bench really unhappy that Rothschild, who looked like he had an easy path to the basket, passed it up in favor of sending it out to the perimeter.
Yeah, I think that is what they're more upset about than the charge call. And a nice job by Trey Phils there to draw it. Looked like it was a bang-bang play position-wise, but Penn did pass up an easy look.
Monroe, little head fake. Now into the lane, Monroe. Pass out to Oney, deflected. Oney gets it anyway, though. On the baseline, able to find Monroe. Gets it off at the shot clock, way short. Shot clock violation. Don't know if a Quaker got a piece of that. That shot ended up a foot or two short of the rim.
Well, the stifling Penn defense continues. Yale shooting under 40% from the field. Penn shooting 57%. Bulldogs 0 of 5 from three-point range.
Oney comes up with a steal. Copeland ahead of him, doesn't see him. Fouled, and it doesn't fall. Antonio Woods picks up the foul. That's his second.
John, I couldn't see it earlier on in the play. It looked like Darnell Foreman just wrapped Oney up near the mid-court line. That wasn't called as we see it here. Yeah, it was Foreman. He went for the ball. Looked like he made contact with Oney. Officials didn't call it, which worked out in Yale's favor as Oney got a chance now to shoot free throws.
They'll take Woods out of the game. Rothschild is in the game playing with two fouls. And look at the foul disparity here in the first half, Josh. I think that's the one thing keeping the Bulldogs in this. Penn with eight fouls, the Bulldogs only one.
Yeah, that's also getting the Penn fan section behind us, right in the ears of the officials.
Bentley for three, yes.
But they've got nothing to complain about with that kind of three-point shooting. 6 of 10 now from distance for the Quakers.
I was going to say, it's hard to... Penn's offense so far getting really good three-point looks. Copeland spins, loses it, and Bentley, well, initially looking to push it in transition now, will slow things down. It's Jake Silpe into the game. Silpe. Rothschild banging against Atkinson. One way, back to the other. misses, and Atkinson rebounds. Fills some space, I think a foot on the line. Oh, no, they'll give him the three.
One of six now for Yale, so they're on the right track. They've cut the lead back, or the deficit, I should say, back down into single digits. Another stop and a basket, and that'll give the fans something to cheer about.
Silpe, pass to Rothschild. Copeland did a nice job rolling to prevent Rothschild from scoring, and then Bentley's three off the side of the backboard. Oney for three, misses, long rebound, Phils comes up with it. We should say that Phils three, Yale's second three in 56 minutes of action against Penn. Copeland's pass, and then a travel called on Goodman, who took away Copeland's pass. I think the Penn bench thought for sure that was going to be a foul on Copeland, and they're not very happy with the traveling violation.
No, they just got a warning as well for players coming up off the bench and onto the playing surface. He did have possession of the ball before he went to the floor, so as much as the Penn fans didn't like the call, it's a tough call to make regardless, but it looked like the official was right on it.
They are trying to post up Oney. Foreman guarding him. Foreman at 6-1, definitely giving up something to Oney. Fills his three, misses. Silpe. Now they'll slow it down.
John, it's not even contested looks that Yale's missing from three. They're just missing in general that you wouldn't really see at right here at the Lee Amphitheater.
Rothschild working against Atkinson. Back to the left hand. Looked like Atkinson got a piece of it initially. Definitely got a piece of it the second time. Monroe at the other end.
Good defense leads to good offense. Great block, and then Eric Monroe, no fear, through contact, went right through the lane, nearly traveled with it, and instead picked up 2 points.
Paul Atkinson's shot blocking and contesting ability, more than anything else in his game, has improved the most this season. He's looked so much more dangerous in that role as the season has gone on. Foul called on the Bulldogs on Eric Monroe, his second. We'll be back in just a minute. Penn leading Yale by 7. They have the basketball, and it's Caleb Wood who will inbound. Wood, 3 of 3 from beyond the arc this half. Woods bumped, gives it to Foreman. Foreman spinning in the lane. Atkinson again does a nice job challenging the shot, and here the Bulldogs go to the other end. Phils, nice move.
What a hesitation and left step from Trey Phils. Went right around the defender, John Wall style, and laid it in.
Rothschild against Atkinson. One way back, the other. Again, Atkinson, what can you say? Oney fouled. No shot, though. Wave off the basket, but Oney will still shoot free throws because Yale is in the bonus. It's the 9th team foul of the half for the Quakers versus only 2 for the Bulldogs.
We've seen Mie Oney do that game in and game out. He just puts his head down, runs perpendicular to the basket, and somehow throws it up, gets it to go, and this time foul was on the floor.
Oney, though, misses the front end of the 1-1. contact. And they're going to give it on Oney. I think Oney actually fouled fouled Wood initially, and then I think Wood started kind of fouling Oney, and that ended up drawing the whistle for the initial contact on Oney.
Well, Yale's done a great job of hustling back and getting easy looks, and of course playing tremendous defense. That's the fifth block already for the Bulldogs. Great job, as you said, John, altering shots.
What can you say? Mie Oney driving baseline and flushing.
A little frustration there from Oney, being called for the foul on one end. Didn't get the layup on the other. Missed the free throw. Comes back and makes sure that this basket goes.
Foreman whistle off the ball. That's on Oney again, his second in about 30 seconds. And that will send him to the bench. Noah Yates checking in for Oney. That's a big loss for the Bulldogs here over the last minute 43. Oney's been so good in transition. Woods three off the mark. Swain rebounds. Yale's going to push it ahead anyway. This time, though, Phils will slow things down.
Yeah, look for Phils and Copeland to now be the go-to guys with Mie Oney off the floor.
Atkinson over to Phils. Swain for three, fouled again. Second time this half that Trey Phils has, or that, excuse me, a Quaker has fouled a Bulldog shooting a three-pointer. First it was on Copeland and now on Azar Swain.
Really not surprised to see Azar Swain pull a couple threes early in this game, despite the fact that Yale just cannot hit threes. He's second on the team in makes from distance at 49, closing in quickly on Mie Oney, although it doesn't look like anybody is going to really increase their three-point mark in this game.
Stay tuned, folks. Coming up at the half, we'll have highlights and stats as well as a feature on Yale Athletic Director, the new Athletic Director, Vicky Chun. Swain misses the first, hits the second. And Jackson Donahue enters the game for the first time. Swain again on the second, and the Bulldogs have made it a one-point game. Game was 28-17 with 8:27 left to play. Yale's turned that 11-point lead now into a 3-point pin lead, and the Quakers will call their use it or lose it timeout with just more than a minute to play. See Oney here, too fast and too strong, going to the basket. And when he gets a full head of steam like that, Josh, not much a defender can do.
No, the only option a defender has is to try to seal off the lane, which we saw on a few transition opportunities for Oney, but he's just so good at finishing around the rim from tough angles that even if he can't dunk it, he'll just try for an acrobatic layup and usually hit it. Now this could be a dangerous last 62 seconds for Yale. Smart time out there for Penn to get the defense set, draw up an offensive play as well. And Penn is known for their tremendous defense.
Yeah, we'll set things up. It's Copeland to Phils.
See what James Jones drew up on the other end.
To Copeland. Off the screen. Jumper misses. Swain, though, with the rebound. Swain, though, quick shot. He didn't really need to do that. Had a fresh shot clock, but Atkinson got that to go.
And now about a two-second difference between the shot clock and the game clock. Saw the raw emotion on Atkinson's face after the finish. Third time's a charm for Yale on that possession.
Foreman will let the shot clock wind down, guarded by Copeland. Now gives it to Wood, back to Foreman. Screen coming, Foreman. On Copeland, step back, misses, ball loose. Goodman did not get that off in time, won't matter. And so we head into the locker room. Bulldogs claw their way back into this game. Quakers lead 35-34. You're watching this on 11 Sports. One-point lead for the Quakers. Second half just about ready to get underway. And we'll bring you those scores from around the Ivy League. We mentioned Princeton leading Brown. That score 32-25. Game taking place in Providence. It's an elimination game. Brown or Princeton, the loser, no chance at the Ivy League tourney. Columbia losing to Dartmouth up in Hanover, 42-31. And the Crimson on top of Cornell, 35-33 at halftime in Cambridge.
So, John, if those four scores stay the way they are, including this one, it would put Columbia in as that fourth spot, although Princeton is still alive.
Oney to inbound. And Yale will get things underway. Starters on the floor for the Bulldogs. It's Copeland, Fills, Oney, Reynolds, and Atkinson. Same for the Quakers as Reynolds going up against one of those starters, A.J. Broder. His pass looking for Oney. Oney managed to get it to Copeland as Foreman nearly got in the way.
I'm sure that's not how James Jones drew up this opening possession.
Copeland a little strong on the layup, out of bounds, Penn basketball. Gonna give you those starters though for the Quakers. Antonio Woods, Darnell Foreman, Ryan Bentley, A.J. Broder, and Max Rothschild. Bentley over to Woods, Woods into the lane, passes it up to Rothschild. Foreman will line up a three, yes.
That's what gave Penn the big early lead in the first half. They go right back to it in the second 20 minutes.
Oney's pass. Saw the right man, just did not make it easy for Trey Fills, threw it right at his feet, and Fills unable to gather.
Fills might have had a look from three there, just a tough pass from Oney. Yale, 1 of 8 from distance in that first half.
Foreman puts his head down into the lane. Bentley in the corner. Pass deflected, Broder and Fills comes up with it. Penn bench wanted a travel. Copeland back to Fills, and it's Reynolds in the lane. Now it's Atkinson. Atkinson, Foreman got a hand in there. Broder comes up with it. Hand off to Woods. Bentley knocked away by Reynolds. But there's a foul.
Well, that was some pretty good defense on both sides, John. And active hands, very active. We've seen that all season long from A.J. Broder defensively.
Bentley to the line, he'll shoot two.
Now this is a way that Yale can come back on the scoreboard. Penn, as a team, just 65% on the season from the free throw line. So where Yale loses points from beyond the arc, they can get them back at the stripe, where Yale as a team shoots over 71%.
The Quakers only 1 of 4 tonight from the stripe. Oni nearly lost it. Now might lose it, but it bounces off the foot of Woods to Reynolds. Fills to the hoop, right hand misses, and picked up by Bentley. Back to Bentley, Yale closes him out quickly, driving baseline, gives it to Broder at the elbow. Bentley left alone in the corner, short. And then Broder fouls Oni, and that's not a smart foul. Hits his third, 90 feet away from the basket. And we'll see if that sends him to the bench.
Well, John, I said it at the start of the first half, and I'll say it again here at the second as Broder does come out. It just seems like Penn gets off to a faster start than Yale does. It almost takes a few minutes of game time for Yale to get the engines going again, where Penn comes out already at 100 miles an hour.
Fills on the wing, left some space, he'll take the three. That's Fills and Yale's second of the game.
That was pretty much a necessity there for the Bulldogs.
Wood left space, tries a three, Oni goes right up over Woods to grab that rebound. Copeland, nice pass to Atkinson. Yale takes the lead. That's their first lead of the game, and it comes 23 minutes into this game. Bulldogs 39, Quakers 38.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
Penn calls a timeout to talk things over as Yale takes its first lead of the game. Bulldogs have played well so far in the second half. It's Foreman, and it's a goaltend. Foreman going to the basket, restores the Penn lead. See Oni being active again. He's been really good, especially on the defensive glass. 8 defensive rebounds on the night. That's by far the most on the team. Atkinson, next highest number with 2. And we've seen Oni really battling, going up strong to pull down some tough defensive rebounds. Here he is on the offensive end. Oni, behind the back, into the lane, sends it to Copeland. Copeland finds some space, misses, and Penn, good rebound by Rothschild. Foreman. Rothschild to Broder. Broder trusted to play with 3 fouls. Foreman pulls up. That's good. He's had quite the night, Darnell Foreman. Make that 16 points to go along with 4 assists. Oni's pass knocked away. Atkinson gets it. Oni from the free throw line gets the roll. Really feels like it's been a high energy game, Josh.
Yeah, well, I think after that timeout is when Yale just like in the first half, that's when they start to pick things up and they realize what they need to do. Get that full head of steam, head to the basket, work those fouls on Penn, and crash the offensive and defensive glass. The last basket by Mieoni was a second chance opportunity.
Fills. Misses short. Foreman rebounds. Long pass ahead for Broder. Oni trying to catch up. Broder did a nice job.
Yeah, what a great stop there by Broder. Oni almost took a seat there, just skidded on the floor right by him.
Reynolds back to Fills for three again. Nobody can buy a three against Penn except Trey Fills. That's his third on the night. And the Bulldogs third for the game.
Yeah, just don't give it to anybody else to shoot the three. Let Fills keep going until he misses. Then maybe have Azar Swain or Mieoni try.
Bentley, the Rothschild, great pass. Bentley unable to finish. Right by Woods again. Timeout on the floor. Bulldogs take a 46-44 lead.
You can make it if you try. You can make it if you try. You can make it if you try. Oh, yeah.
Yale with a 2-point lead, and Penn with the basketball without Darnell Foreman. Foreman's been just fantastic tonight. 16 points on 7 of 10 shooting from the field to go along with 5 assists and no turnovers. Quakers, though, get it to go without him. That's Woods from the wing hitting the 3. His first points of the night. Reynolds back out to Fills. Reynolds thought about it. Now Phil's going baseline. Bounced off his knee and Penn in transition. Bentley, I think it was Yates maybe who got a piece of that.
Yeah, great chase down defense there from Noah Yates.
Monroe to the floor, somehow keeps it alive. And Oni, blocking foul called on Woods. His third. And that will send me Oni to the free throw line.
A lot of 50-50 calls in this game, and a lot of them seem to be going Yale's way. That one, no call necessary. Mieoni did it on one end in the first half, and another two-handed baseline jam in the second.
Well, and it looked like he had to get his head out of the way, otherwise it would have clipped the underside of the backboard. Tomorrow on 11 Sports, we head west to the Big Sky Conference. Watch Montana State take on Weber State tomorrow at 4 p.m. Eastern Time, right here on 11 Sports.
John, I was trying to think about it a little bit, and I know that this may seem like a pretty big comparison to make, but in terms of the Ivy League, playing Penn is almost like playing the Golden State Warriors, where they're just a really good defensive team, and they shoot the heck out of the ball from three, where you have a Steph Curry, Klay Thompson, who can shoot really well, and then defensively, Draymond Green and Kevin Durant. It's so hard to get by them. Penn just shuts down opponents from the field, and they come back on the other end without any hesitation and can shoot and hit from wherever.
Definitely shooting like that tonight. 7 of 15 from beyond the arc. Goodman. Nice move. Can't finish off the play, though.
Tried to get a little too fancy in a tie ball game.
Monroe back to Reynolds. He'll line one up. That misses, but Oney an offensive rebound.
Second chance opportunities continue to help the Bulldogs. 11-2 scoring on second chance points.
Oney off the dribble, yes.
Make that 13-2.
Oney 12 points tonight. Foul, it was Yates who tried to push through A.J. Broder. That'll lead to a timeout on the floor. Bulldogs have climbed back into this one and taken the lead, 49-47. You're watching this on 11 Sports.
We hope you're enjoying our re-air the 2018 Yale Penn men's basketball game. It's the second half, and we're joined by another special guest, Yale assistant coach and member of the class of 2004, Justin Simon. And Justin, my first question is the simple one. Why'd you choose Yale as a player?
Well, I was fortunate enough they wanted me to come play for them. Really, the degree speaks for itself. You know, it was part of Coach Jones's first recruiting class. All the way back in 2000, and, you know, the energy and excitement he had about the program and the university was unmatched and just made it feel like home.
So Yale chose you as a player. So tell us a little bit about the road back to Yale as a coach.
You know, Coach Jones had stayed a constant in my life. I'd gotten into a little bit of education and coaching basketball at the high school level. And as soon as there was an opportunity to come back for Yale, for me, it was a home run. I was able to bring my family back to where a lot of things began for me and live on this campus.
Justin, when we talk about this 2017-18 team, it was a very talented team, but injuries are very much a part of the story, and they struck the Bulldogs early in the year.
Man, to have to go that whole season with Makai Mason, who was going to be a senior and the best player in the Ivy League that year, and Jordan Bruner, who had proven as a freshman he was going to be a force to be reckoned with. You know, those two guys were in street, and really it was a tough adjustment early on.
With this team, a very, very difficult schedule to start the year, and it seemed like you guys were on the road the entire month of November.
That's kind of been our thing over the last couple of years. We really enjoy challenging ourselves with some of these road games. Now, we got the phone call from the doctor that Makai had stress fractures on our way to Creighton, and we did look into turning the plane around coming back from Omaha.
When we look at this season, a lot of what happened was setting up for the championship run in 18-19. And the Bulldogs were on a little bit of a roll coming into this Penn game.
Yeah, it was great. And really hitting that last weekend, the way the league was set up was we didn't have a whole lot to play for. We had sort of locked ourselves into the 3 seed for the upcoming Ivy League tournament. But really to go back and rewatch this game from 2018, to see, you know, Paul Atkinson and Azar Swain running around as freshmen and Mie only as a sophomore. Just to think the next year Mie was going to be the Ivy League Player of the Year and the following year Paul was, it was really fun to go back and watch.
You're right, and I asked Coach Jones about this as well, but Trey Fills led the team in scoring in this game, and you all asked him to do a lot of different things over the course of his 4 years in Yale Blue.
Trey showed up every day with no ego. You know, as a junior without – Makai and without Jordan, he needed to assume a little bit more of the scoring role. And he did that and ended up being a second team all-league player. And then his senior year, every single game, we put him on the toughest matchup. And it hurt his scoring a little bit, but it impacted our winning. And Trey never complained. And gosh, he's going to go down as one of the best defensive players we've ever had here at Yale.
Double-double from Mie Oney as well. And the growth of Mie from his rookie campaign the year before through his time at Yale were just incredible. 23 points in this game.
Yeah, and he had 3 dunks that I don't even remember. It just goes to show how often he made these wow athletic plays in JLA during his career. But just the confidence that he started to play with the second half of his sophomore year. I think carried him all the way through his junior year and obviously onto the NBA.
All right, you watched the film. So break down the end for us. Down three multiple times in the last 15 seconds and down three again with the ball and 7 seconds left. Take us through the winning plays at the end of an incredible night at JLA.
Well, it was an interesting game. Penn decided that they were going to foul up three rather than let us get a chance to shoot a three-pointer. And what ended up happening was a few times in there, we got fouled. We missed some of our free throws. They missed some of their free throws. But really what ended up happening is Mie got fouled about 3 seconds left, down three. He made the first. He looked like he wanted to intentionally miss the second. It ends up going in. And so it set up that dead ball situation with them taking the ball out under the basket, leading by one. And that's where, we denied the inbounds pass. Azar made a great play, getting a deflection, and we end up getting the ball off the replay, which feels like that doesn't happen very often.
That it did, with the Bulldogs getting the 80-79 win over the Penn Quakers. Justin, thank you for your time, and we look forward to talking to you again as our re-air series continues.
Thanks a lot, Evan. Have a wonderful day.
That was Yale assistant coach Justin Simon. Our re-air of Yale and Penn continues now.
Fills to the hoop, blocked. Rothschild got a piece, Woods the other way. Goodman, and just can't get it to go, but he'll head to the line.
Well, I get the impression that Steve Donahue had a message for his guys, and that was go for the defensive rebound. Stop letting Yale get those offensive rebounds on that last drive by Trey Fills. There were four blue shirts right in that restricted area. No chance for Yale on the rebound.
Well, what's remarkable about that, Josh, is they've been both able to send bodies to the defensive glass, but also get out in transition against this Yale team. Free throws are good, and Broder will enter the game. Jake Silpe to the bench. Swain, they're looking for Atkinson. Atkinson nearly lost it. Now we'll go to work against Rothschild. Back out to Swain for three. Misses. And Penn again, great job on the defensive glass. Foreman leaked and misses the shot. Oh my goodness.
Well, he's been cheating up ahead a few possessions now, and that's why Penn puts four for the rebound to ensure that they get it, and they have one streaker down the field, down the court.
And that's looking to take advantage of Yale being aggressive, crashing the offensive glass. Reynolds step back. Foreman. Nice pass to Broder. They give it to Rothschild. Rothschild against Atkinson again. This time with the right hand, and that's way too strong. Rothschild hasn't looked comfortable at all working against Atkinson.
Maybe see if Atkinson can find something on the offensive end. This has been a few empty possessions in a row now for the Bulldogs.
He'll come out to set the screen. Copeland looking to get it back to him. Instead gives it to Reynolds.
Yeah, they had a chance, but just missed it.
Fills in the corner. Tough shot, but it's good as Rothschild was looking to draw the charge. Really minimal contact between him and Fills. And I like that no call.
And you see that a lot from somebody like LeBron James, who just has those massive shoulders. He takes one jab step forward, the defender goes down.
Wonderful pass by Rothschild. He's pumped up about that one, and Goodman finishes. Reynolds somehow gets it to Atkinson, who gets fouled, and the bucket is good. Atkinson, 12 points tonight. Penn 59, Yale 56.
You can make it if you try.
Atkinson at the free throw line. He'll try to complete the three-point play. Atkinson, 12 points, 4 rebounds, 3 assists, and 3 blocks tonight. Huge game by the freshman. He's maybe put up better numbers this season, Josh, but I don't know if we've seen him play a better game, particularly given the level of competition.
And the way he's played on defense and the things that don't show up in the stat sheet, like altering shots and just being that presence in the middle, has been a big factor to help Yale stay relevant.
Caleb Wood, refining the stroke, knocks down the three, 15 points for him. Swain. Pin hands, so active defensively. Phil somehow got that to go. He released it about 3 feet from the floor because he was going down.
Yeah, while falling down with the left hand. What an acrobatic finish.
Woods pass off the hands of Broder. Broder, similar play.
Yeah, Broder saw Phil's do it and said, I can do it too.
Atkinson, hands off to Oney. 15 seconds. Oney for three. Misses. Phil's offensive rebound. He's double teamed, able to find Atkinson. And then a foul, reach in, I believe on Woods. Yep.
Well, this is another second chance opportunity for the Bulldogs. And they've done really well so far as we see that Trey Phil's finish again. Just so tough with the offhand and the answer on the other end.
That's Woods' fourth foul, so he'll go to the bench. Big possession for the Bulldogs. Really would like to keep this a one possession game. Phil's to Reynolds. Reynolds, contact. All ball, and so it will stay with the Bulldogs.
8 seconds to shoot on the shot clock. We've seen Penn in this situation a few times, and they've converted some big baskets. See if Yale can answer as well.
Atkinson fouled. That'll go against Devin Goodman, his second. Atkinson back to the free throw line. Knocks down the first. His free throw shooting at 66% on the year. They're both good, and it's a one possession game.
Not surprised that we see some pressure here for the Bulldogs. I think until they tie or take the lead, we'll continue to see that.
Oney got out that time to close down Wood. Foreman passes off to Broder. Broder gets it to go. 14 points tonight for him. Phil's, Reynolds, back to Phil's for three. He's feeling it, Trey Phil's, 20 points tonight. Phil made four from beyond the arc.
He's the only one that can. Great to see him find his range consistently outside of the three-point arc
in what could be the biggest win of the season for the Bulldogs.
Broder. Wood again. What can you say? Caleb Wood, 18 points. And he's killed Yale tonight.
5 of 8 from distance for Wood.
Oney misses, but gets his own offensive rebound. Copeland pulls up short. This time Penn able to collect. Goodman. Pass taken away by Copeland. Yale with transition. And behind the play, an offensive foul on Blake Reynolds. Yale was in transition the other way, and Reynolds whistled for the foul. We did not see that one. We'll see if we can take a look when we come back.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
And we're back. The officials taking a look at the monitor. I think to review that last play, as we said, Yale in transition. It was Oney leading the break, and then the whistle blown for something at the other end. Reynolds picked up the foul.
Yeah, what we heard is that two players got tangled beneath the Penn basket, and what the official saw is Reynolds might have kicked the Penn player's legs when the two of them were on the floor. Very tough call to make. Of course, neither of us saw it. We were focused on the action at the other end. But that's a major call to make as well in a 5-point game. So it'll be offensive foul on Yale. No flagrant, just Penn basketball.
Yeah, you can see Reynolds get tangled up with Goodman, and then we're kind of able to sneak a look at the officials' monitor, and then it looked like, let's see if we can get this to come up on the broadcast monitor, but it looked like, it didn't look like much from our vantage point. And we'll see. Based on the look we got, not really sure what the official saw. But, those are the breaks, and it'll be Penn basketball.
That also put both teams at 6 fouls, so the next fouls will start shooting 1-1.
Pass underneath, Broder. Back out to Foreman. Foreman. And fouled by Phils. Tune in this weekend on 11 Sports for the first round of the ECAC Hockey Championship as the Yale Bulldogs and the Quinnipiac Bobcats duke it out to see who will advance to the ECAC quarterfinals. Tomorrow's game will be streaming live on Twitch at 7 p.m. Eastern Time at 11 Sports Prime. And just like that, Penn's opened up a 7-point lead. Things haven't been working for Yale at the offensive end.
It was a 2-point game just a few minutes ago. A couple of fouls, missed baskets.
Mie Oni throws it down. Timeout, Yale. 17 points for Oni.
Well, I think James Jones is drawing up some full court pressure here to hopefully cause a trap and a turnover. Yale gets another basket. Doesn't matter if it's a three or a two. This is a one possession game. And John, if it were me, I think that the Bulldogs just need to focus on high percentage looks. Don't worry about the three. You can't tie the game with one shot. And Mie Oni, that's his third 100% shot of the night. He's going to make that every time.
Yeah, Trey Phil's the only guy that's had any luck from beyond the arc. He's 4 of 5 tonight. Otherwise, Yale 0 of 10 from beyond the arc. And I think you're right, Josh. It will be Copeland coming over to apply pressure to Goodman.
I'm surprised that the Bulldogs just back right off.
Bentley to Broder. That's Wood to the corner. Goodman for three, misses.
I like that by Copeland. Stuck out his left hand to slow down the pace, and now Oni will run the offense. Doesn't matter how long it takes to get a basket, they just need one.
Oni to Phils for three, misses. And he was fouled on the shot. Third time tonight, Yale shooter fouled on a 3-point attempt. Happened to Copeland once, Swain once, and now Phils.
Now, John, I know we've seen a few times this season of opponents here.
Oh, no, hold on a sec. I think they're going to say a foul maybe after the shots. And so Phils will shoot the 1-and-1. Not totally sure of the call. I don't know if you, but this is the 1-and-1. And Phils good on the first.
Well, I was going to say, we've seen opponents here at the Lee Amphitheater get a few fouls on threes, and they get the three shots. I don't think we've seen Yale get this many opportunities on three-pointers, but this one was erased.
Phils hits both, two crucial free throws, 22 points tonight for Trey Phils. Looking to feed Broder. Atkinson gets back over. Broder backing him down. Kicks it out. Goodman refeeds Broder. Atkinson. Broder. Nice move.
Atkinson is a first year, and he did give up a basket, but he does not play like a first year.
Oni to Yates. Over to Phils. Oni gets it back. Out to Phils. Kicks it around. Copeland open for three. In and out. Phils with the follow. Misses. Yates comes up with it. And Yale another chance. Yates for three. Misses. And Penn able to corral it. 4 minutes ahead to Wood. And the question is, will Yale try to foul? I think they need to. Bentley, ball loose. And there's the whistle.
Well, they didn't want to there. Mie Oni called for it at the last second. They had Penn on the ropes there for a moment, unsure of what to do with the ball. Triple team coming over, and Oni just got his hand too far inside.
Penn shooting the 1-and-1. And a foul underneath on Broder. And that really damaging. Not only does it give Yale the ball, it gives them free throws, a chance to put some points on the board with the clock stopped, and it'll be Atkinson heading to the line to shoot the 1-1.
Got a few close games still in the Ivy League. Dartmouth up 3 on Columbia with a minute 20 to play. Harvard up 3 on Cornell with 2.5 to go.
Atkinson misses the front end. Yates fouls.
But with a win tonight over Yale, Penn will secure that number one spot in the Ivy League, no matter what Harvard does tonight against Cornell and tomorrow against Columbia.
Foreman misses the front end. And Yale, another chance here. They trail by only 5, just need to get a basket. Copeland behind the back, lays it in. And James Jones will use another timeout. Alex Copeland, so quick, and you saw it right there as he got to the basket.
Great crossover dribble that opened the lane wide up, and Copeland went straight through for the easy finish. John, I think now in this timeout, James Jones is drawing up that full court pressure. Yale won't back off. They'll try for the trap or the steal, and then they have to go into foul mode.
Darnell Foreman, 19 points, 7 assists, 5 rebounds tonight for Penn. He's been fantastic.
Well, he has. He's been all around a great scorer. 2 of 3 from beyond the arc as well. 7 of 12 shooting. Caleb Wood, you have to give him a lot of credit too. 5 3-point makes for him tonight.
And you have to imagine, we'll see who Pim looks to get the ball to. Foreman, a pretty solid free throw shooter, 72%. Caleb Wood also pretty decent at 72%. But as you said, this is not a great free throw shooting team, only 65% on the season.
Yeah, Bentley is.
And we've seen that as they missed 2 front ends of the 1-1 in a row.
Yeah, Bentley might be the best option. He's 78.5% on the season. Right now he's standing just in front of us near half court.
And we should note the next foul will put Penn into the double bonus. And so they'll shoot 2 free throws.
There's the trap.
Broder.
Need the quick
foul. Gets it ahead to Goodman. And now Yale needs to foul, and they do.
Yeah, they get it to Wood, who is just a 70.5% free throw shooter on the season. I'm a little surprised that Bentley just didn't hold on to it. Although he saved the team an extra second, maybe. He's the much better free throw shooter.
And Wood misses the first. Blake Reynolds will come into the game for Atkinson.
Crowd's excited about that miss, but still a make here on the second, and it's a 2-possession game.
Yeah, a miss though, and Yale can maybe hold, try to get the final shot to send this into overtime. Now they do make. And so now a quick bucket's what Yale needs regardless. 2-3, they'll take either one.
Yeah, but based on the success from three-point range, I don't think Yale wants to risk that.
Oni to Phils. Phils hands off to Oni. And there's a foul. It's on Woods, his 5th. And so he's out of this game. And that will send Mie Oni to the free throw line to shoot the 1-1. And we talked a little bit about it tonight. Josh, Oni has struggled from the stripe.
Very true, John. He's just 3 of 7 from the free throw line. Almost uncharacteristic. And when you look at the grand scheme of this game, he goes 5 of 7. These could be 2 free throws to tie things up.
That's a big one. Only able to put those other misses out of his head. Azar Swain, it looks like, waiting to check in. Oney hits them both, and it's, I think, Mie Oney who is going to, oh, no, Alex Copeland is who he will replace. Yale with the full court pressure. Penn gets it in, and a quick foul. Actually, I don't know if Yale wanted to foul there, but they'll take it.
Yeah, the ball got up the court there, and Yale was just kind of forced into it. But once again, one of two from the line, and Yale is still in it.
So Penn, another chance here at the free throw line. It's Wood to shoot two. Went one of two the last time. This time hits the first.
Now he was short on that first free throw he took when he missed it. And ever since then, he has got it spot on.
Hits both. Goodman and Rothschild into the game. And the Quakers will call a timeout. After this one, both Yale and Penn have a timeout apiece. What are you looking for here if you're the Bulldogs?
Well, with 17 and a half seconds to go, I hate to say it, but I think you need to think about a three here because the quick baskets are working for Yale. They're getting them, or they're getting to the free throw line as if it was a quick basket, but Wood hit the two free throws, and that puts pressure on Yale. They just can't keep exchanging 2 points at a time. If the Bulldogs want to come back, a big three and then a foul almost sets Penn back on their heels and throws off the rhythm. But obviously the toughest part of that is hitting the three. So far this game, Yale, minimal success, 4 of 17, much better than 1 of 19 in the first meeting.
Yeah, and I don't think you would have said, we would have thought, Josh, that Trey Fields might be the guy they're trying to find. He's only a 29% three-point shooter this season. Has shot the ball better in Ivy League play at 38%, but tonight he's been hot, 4 of 5 from deep, the only Bulldog with a three. That said, though, I think Mie Oney's the guy. I know he struggled this season from beyond the arc, 32% and 28% in Ivy League play. But as far as a guy who you trust can get a pretty good shot off the dribble quickly, I think it's probably Oney.
Yeah, and he's cold-blooded. He's got no fear as well. It's a good lineup in for Yale, obviously, that we've seen. Trey Fills hit some threes this game. Alex Copeland just off the mark on a few, and Mie Oney, the same thing.
Here comes Oney. Up to Fills in the corner. He was hit on the wrist. You could see it from here, too. And that will send Fills to the line.
Well, it's not how you draw it up, but if it works, it works. Now he just has to convert. And the frustration from Steve Donahue on these threes. Regardless if Penn comes out of this game with a win or not, he is going to lay into his team for this.
Fills misses the first. Now an interesting question. I think Fills needs to make the next one, certainly. He does. And now if you're Yale, a miss here, chance at an offensive rebound, and then a three would tie it. But Fills hits, and so that allows Yale to make substitution, set up the defense, and try to trade free throws once again.
Yeah, and I think without Atkinson in the game, that Yale had to try to make that free throw instead of going for the offensive rebound. Azar Swain checked in, and he's another three-point marksman for the Bulldogs. They just need to hope for a steal or one of two at the line from Penn.
Sam Jones comes into the game. That's his first, I think his first action tonight. And I believe this will be Sam Jones' first free throw attempts of the season.
Yep. He does not get that many minutes. He's played in 21 games, but averages just 5 minutes per contest. He's a good three-point shooter, but as you said, has yet to take a free throw, and what a time this is. Good foul for Yale.
This will be his second and third non-three-point attempts of the season. And he misses the first. 39 of his 40 shots this year have been from three. No free throws until that one. And the Bulldogs, a chance here to tie the game.
Yeah, you almost question that decision to sub him in, knowing that if he gets the ball, Yale will foul him.
It's the second, and Penn will call a timeout.
And I think this will be the last possession of the ball game.
Well, so we go to the question here, Josh. If you're Penn, do you try to foul?
Well, with the luck that the Quakers have had on fouling three-point shooters, I don't think you want to take that risk and just let the shot happen. Who knows? We've seen it before that if a shooter, even if they're not in the shooting motion or within 50 feet of the basket, they could still get the three free throws. So if you're Penn, I think you just want to try to guard the perimeter, not give up an easy shot, but not foul. That's the worst case scenario right now for Penn. Of course, when you look at the shooting percentage for the Bulldogs, you can give up a three. Chances are Yale's not going to make it. On the offhand that they do, there could be a few seconds left.
On the floor for the Quakers, it's Rothschild, Silpe, Foreman, Goodman, and Broder. For the Bulldogs, Oney, Fills, Yates, Copeland, and Reynolds to inbound. Penn applying some full court pressure. 11.3 left to go. Yale trails by three. And it's Oney who will take it. Mie Oney getting a screen foul on Darnell Foreman. And so Mie Oney will head to the free throw line. 8.3, still plenty of time left.
Yeah, I thought that was a little quick for the foul. This still allows two free throws, Penn to inbound, Yale to foul, and then get the ball back after free throws.
Potentially at that point, well, I'll have to see how the free throws go, but Oney to shoot. And Oney makes the first. Second is good as well. 1 point game. And James Jones will call a timeout. I like this decision here. See if you can set up something to force a turnover. And more importantly, I think, not stopping the play between whatever happens after potentially Penn free throws works to the Bulldogs' advantage, because otherwise Penn has time to set up and a chance. Maybe it makes it a little easier to foul. Yeah. If assuming that Penn makes both these free throws.
And a chance to sub as well. So this is no more timeouts in the ball game for either team. This one is going to come right down to the wire. It was a low-scoring game the first time these two teams met, 59-50. Penn win at the Palestra, but this time the offenses were on display, and you have to give the Bulldogs credit. The three was not falling, but they found a way to stay competitive in this game.
And this is a three-point shooting lineup on the floor. Oney, Swain, Fills, Reynolds, and Yates. Silpe to inbound. Can run the baseline. And gets it into Foreman, who's fouled quickly by Swain, 7.4. Less than a second ticks off the clock. Foreman, a 72% shooter from the line. He's had a really nice game tonight. 19 points, 7 assists, 5 rebounds. Foreman hits the first. The second on the way, yes. And now Yale to set up. Oney.
Give Penn credit as well for all these free throws made.
Oney coming up court. And he's fouled, and he really needed to get that three-pointer off. I don't know if Yale will have enough time at this point. Smart heads-up play by the Penn defense. Give them a ton of credit. With 3.6 to play, that's the best possible, I think, well, that's about as good as you could have drawn it up, Josh.
Yeah, that's what I was expecting on the last possession. Instead of the foul with 7.5 seconds to go,
Let Yale almost set something up, and then right before they get it to the trigger man, foul.
Well, that's what I was hoping to see. I know there wasn't a ton of maybe coming off the dribble, not the best look, but I almost knew Penn was going to foul in that situation, and Oney passed up on a chance maybe to pull up and try a three. Instead, Oney will go to the line, though. Still time left. And again, he needs to make both. Hits the first. And question here is, if he misses the next one, as Atkinson going to come in for Noah Yates, if he misses the second, James Jones wants Blake Reynolds and Paul Atkinson in there to contest for the offensive rebound.
Yeah, of course. That's why Atkinson just checked in. And you have to imagine there's going to be a fight underneath the basket.
Oney thinking about it. And he makes it. I think he was trying to miss it, though.
Yeah, he wanted to miss right.
Penn trying to inbound. They get it to Foreman out of bounds. Yale basketball. But they will take a look at the monitor. They will take a look. The initial call, Yale basketball. Swain had his hand in there. Foreman, the one is the Penn player going after it. Well, and this is reviewable.
Hopefully we can get the look that the officials do as well. The big call here, John, is that it is Yale basketball was the initial call. So the officials have to find enough evidence to overturn that. Great heads-up play by Swain. It's a little tough to tell from the opposite angle whose hand was where, although Swain does have that long sleeve on.
I was going to say, from that angle, it almost looked like Swain may be more responsible for pushing it out. I think the question is, did it come off of Foreman again after Swain dislodged the ball?
Yeah. And is there enough evidence to overturn that and give the ball to Penn?
Yeah, that you're exactly right. That initial call, huge.
And Azar Swain was a late substitution. He wasn't in the ball game for a lot of this final minute. Came on and made potentially the biggest play of the game for Yale. Just really tough to tell, John.
Yeah, it's really tough. Although it does look like, oh, man.
I think the official's right
in front of us.
Question
is, did Foreman's right hand come off of it last? So Swain gets his left arm in there, knocks the ball loose. And then did Foreman maybe try to recover and grab it? I don't know.
Yeah, it almost looks like Foreman's right hand across his body, but you have to just watch the whole thing so slowly and follow Swain's left hand and Foreman's right hand.
Yeah, I mean, I think looking at this, if without the call on the floor, I would have said this is Penn basketball, but I think you're right. The initial call of Yale basketball makes this a tough one to overturn.
You know that the Penn fan base behind us has been heckling the officials all game. And a call here for Yale, even if it's the right call, is just going to make them, the whole place is going to erupt regardless of the call. Plenty of Yale fans, plenty of Penn fans. It's a nice FaceTime here for Tim Bennett.
Yale Sports Information Director for basketball. Penn. So let's talk through this, though, Josh. We'll see, actually. Official is going to deliberate, but
I'm surprised they didn't bring over the third official here.
Yale basketball. They're going to talk it over with Steve Donahue.
Yeah, and I think the official's trying to explain to him before he gets teed up and really loses the game for his team that the call on the floor was Yale basketball, and there wasn't enough evidence to overturn that.
Yale to inbound. Reynolds from the corner. Oney, Phils, Atkinson, and Azar Swain on the floor. Bentley to guard the inbound pass. Reynolds over to Oney. Oney passes to Atkinson, lays it in! Yale wins! Paul Atkinson at the buzzer!
Officials coming over to check the monitor just to make sure he got it off in time. Sure did look like it from our angle. Of course, they could put a few ticks back on the clock. You need at least 0.3 to have a chance at a shot. I don't think Penn cares either way, John. They're walking off the floor.
I think he got it off in time, and that, I think, was right at the buzzer. I don't think there's any time left. We'll see, though. Waiting for the official word. But what a play. Oney recognizing they had time, got it to Atkinson, and Paul Atkinson, the freshman, his best, the best game of the season, best game of his career, finishes it off.
Excuse any foul language you may hear. The Penn fans are a little upset behind us. And Penn walking off the floor.
Paul?
Yeah, and we're gonna see if we can get Paul Atkinson to come over and talk to us. Penn, I think the officials say there are 0.3 seconds left, and Penn left the floor. I don't know if they wanna even finish it off. I don't think they do. I think the Quakers are just gonna leave.
I think they're very frustrated with the officiating from this game. We saw that big disparity, John. You pointed it out early in the first half. It was 8-1 in terms of fouls. And then here down the stretch. And the Yale fans booing because Penn didn't want to come out and finish the game. I think the big point here, John, what the fans miss and that people without our vantage point miss of seeing the replay is that you need to have evidence to overturn the call on the floor. It doesn't matter what the call on the floor was. You need to be able to overturn it.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
The officials just couldn't do that.
Well, and I think, you know, the frustration goes back to foul disparity in the first half, where Penn racked up 10 fouls. I think Yale only had 4. And so with 0.3 seconds left, the Quakers are going to have to go the length of the court. See, Atkinson, yep, right about 0.3 seconds left. And so the Quakers, it'll be Rothschild, I think, who will try to throw this the length of the court. And again, 0.3. Rothschild throws it. Goodman not off in time, and that'll do it. What a way to end that one, Josh. Bulldogs 80, Penn 79. Paul Atkinson at the buzzer. And I think we'll see if we can... It'll be, I think maybe Mie Oney actually is going to come over and talk to us. And it will be Mie Oney. Oney tonight, 23 points.
Yeah, what a tremendous performance there from Mie Oney at the end, giving it up to Paul Atkinson for that final basket of the game. Just a tremendous performance from you, Mie, and this was probably the grittiest win that you guys have had to pull out this season. You took a ton of free throws at the end of the game. Why don't you just walk us through how that final minute of action went?
And it was wild. I've never been in a game like that. That was really, we extended the game with the free throws. We hit ours, they didn't, and we got an opportunity. Azar made an incredible defensive play. I mean, Trey getting fouled on 3 shots, giving us more free throws with the time stop. Paul with the over the back call, giving us points from the time. Wasn't running, it was huge. So we extended the game, we got an opportunity, and we executed the play at the end.
Now, if we look at the larger picture of how this game played out, once again, Penn just stifled you guys from behind the three-point arc. You managed to hang in there, going back and forth, came within 2, got the lead, then went back down 5. How did this team stay competitive?
We just knew we were always in it. We knew we had a fight. I mean, we would play really competitive in practice, preparing ourselves for the games, and we feel like we can play with anyone now. We can compete and win games late. So it's a really good feeling to get this win.
This is probably the biggest win of the season against the top team in the Ivy League right now. You guys are locked into that 3 spot in the Ivy League tournament regardless. But what did you learn about the team tonight that you can take into next weekend?
I mean, I learned that we have grit. I mean, look, we have 2 freshmen making 2 huge plays at the end. Like, that speaks a lot to the coaching staffs and our team chemistry and everything like that. So, yeah.
Leone, it was not a quiet game for you as well. You put up some big numbers, rebounding, scoring, but at the end it came down to an assist to Paul Atkinson. What was going through your mind when you had the ball with 2 seconds to go?
I mean, Blake made a great pass to me. I knew that I was going to get a closeout and I'll be able to drive by my man. And once I drive by my man, I'm going to draw some attention. So Paul was wide open for the dump off and he finished it.
And one more home game tomorrow before the Ivy League playoff. What is the goal against Princeton?
Our goal is to just compete and play hard like we did tonight and get revenge on them for last time.
Niaoni, thank you very much. Yale pulls off a last second 80-79 thriller over Penn. Probably the biggest win of the season for the Bulldogs as they wrap up that number three position and head into the Ivy League tournament next week.